can't see you. I'm looking into the darkness. That's fine. Anyway, how lovely to be here. Thank you so much for welcoming me to this extraordinary place where it's marvelous that there's dance and art and writing and music all going on all around us. And what nice things Meg says. A little terrifying, actually, when you listen to somebody saying such positive things, you think, oh my God, I'll never be able to do that again. Anyway, never mind. I'm going to read you from my new novel, and she beautifully started it off for me by telling you that it's set all, well, mostly in 3 weeks in a house in the country in the west of England. I thought at first when I was writing it, it was all going to be in that 3 weeks. And then as I was writing, I knew that was too flattened. And somewhere in the middle, I dive back 40 odd years and we find ourselves in the same house, same people, but it's May 1968, so more about that anon. But at the moment we're here, we're in more or less the present. And the first bit I'm going to read you, there are four siblings who have gathered from their different lives in different places. They're city people, actually. And they've gathered back at this old house in the country, which means so much to them because it was their grandparents' house. Their grandfather was the minister in the little church which is next door. And they spent a lot of their childhood there, mostly holidays and other occasions when their mother brought them back there. Now they are all adults. This house is falling to bits. Their grandparents are dead. Actually, their mother is dead. And really, they ought to sell it. Its roof needs a new roof. None of them can afford that. They don't use it enough. And yet, of course, it's the repository of all this memory. So the first scene I'm going to read is quite early on in the book, and it's between two sisters, Harriet and Alice. Harriet is the oldest, and maybe you'll find out what she's like. I probably don't need to explain her. Alice and she are quite contrasting. Harriet holds everything in. Alice gives everything out. And something odd, you just need to know, has happened to Harriet the night before. Her bedroom upstairs is adjacent to her brother's room. And her brother has arrived at the house with his new wife, his third wife, a very glamorous, handsome Argentinian woman, rather different to his family. And inadvertently, the night before the bit I'm going to read, a door was left open between their two bedrooms, and when Harriet arrived upstairs, after the end of the evening, she eavesdropped involuntarily on her brother making love to his new wife. One of those embarrassing things that can just happen, and normally you'd think, oh God, quickly shut the door, pretend I didn't notice anything. But it has a galvanizing effect on Harriet. She couldn't have imagined in advance that it would mean anything to her, but it seems to smite her with the recognition, I suppose, of a sexuality and a passion that she has put away and discounted in her own life anyway. So this is the following morning. Upstairs, Harriet was standing in her brother's bedroom. The sash windows were thrown open high, and she could hear her sister's voices from the garden, although she couldn't hear their words. She didn't want to. Dust motes swarmed in the sunlight, and the thick, hot silence inside the room seemed strongly printed with its absent inhabitants, who had marked it with their scent of cosmetics and perfume and aftershave. They had made up the bed with a duvet cover and pillowcases patterned in swirls of red and orange. The old-fashioned, faded furniture seemed to hold stiffly back from an invasion. Harriet, too, was holding herself back. She was rusty. The joints of her spirit creaked and groaned with disuse. And yet, she had crept in here. Possessed by what she had seen last night, she could not free herself from its violence, its excitement. She had not reckoned with this power of sex. In all seriousness, she had believed that it didn't count for her, that sex was a thing among other things that you could put aside. putting her face up against the scarlet chiffon blouse whose hanger was slung over the wardrobe's upper rim. Not touching it at first with her hands, she stood breathing through its veil. The frail fabric rose and fell against her lips and cheeks, lifted by her breath. She tasted its sun-warmed laundry smell. How grotesque she must look with this draped over her face, if anyone ever saw. Outside, she heard the drowsing, inward-absorbed cooing of the doves hidden in the full summer skirts of the beech trees. Lifting down the blouse on its hanger, she carried it off into her own room where she laid it on the bed. And when she had closed both the doors, she pulled off her t-shirt, then unhooked her bra and dropped it on the floor. With hasty, clumsy fingers, she pulled Pilar's blouse over her head. It floated against her naked chest. The silk was raw against her breasts. I am inside what she will wear, Harriet thought. What would it feel like to be Pilar? To be so beautiful inside your clothes, to wear them with such assurance and fit with that easy grace inside your own skin. It was as if the other woman belonged to a different, superior species. Then she stared at herself as punishment in the little round mirror on its stand on top of the chest of drawers. How lucky that her room was on the shady side of the house and the chest of drawers was in the shadows too, on the wall opposite the window. What she saw was something that ought to be kept hidden. The blouse made her grotesque. It insulted her as vividly as a slap or a derisory remark. Its brilliant red sucked away colour from her skin and its low neck sagged against her jutting, freckled collarbones. She saw that her old woman's haircut, chopped off short at her ears, sticking up on top, wasn't modest or sensible as she'd hoped, but a humiliating mistake. Reaching up inside the transparent material, she touched her breast again, watching herself in disgust. Its flesh was cold, nosing against her hand like an old dog. Changed back into her own t-shirt, Harriet sat on the side of her bed to write in her diary. "I saw a hawk lift up out of a field," she wrote. "Such heavy effort of the shoulders, wingtips dipping, the whole noble drama of its movement. I am nothing." When Harriet went downstairs and stepped into the drawing room, thinking she would have it to herself, she found Alice there, kneeling on the floor beside their grandmother's bureau, poking into its lock with something. "Whatever are you doing?" Alice was startled, but not abashed. "I'm trying to pick the lock," she said. "Do you know how? Danny can do it, but I haven't got his knack. I just have this feeling that there are letters in here which might be interesting, don't you think? Otherwise, why keep it locked? I don't know why I haven't wanted to before." Harriet was horrified by the rage that overwhelmed her. Hadn't she unlearned this years ago? It had been peace when she stopped hating Alice. "You can't do that. Whatever's in there is private. You shouldn't look at it." "They're dead, Harriet. Don't be ridiculous. If we don't read their stuff, who will? I want to read their letters because I'm remembering them. I love them. Would it be better to forget them?" "Granny would have hated you digging around in her private life. If you do find letters in there, you ought to burn them." Alice sat back on her heels, staring at her sister. "What's got into you? You're in a mood. And what I said at breakfast wasn't just romantic either, by the way. I know you agree with me that things are ugly and awful. Why are you making up to Pilar? She wouldn't approve of your work with asylum seekers. You needn't think so. I should think she's pretty unsentimental about them." "You're so judgmental, Alice. We hardly know her. You don't know what she thinks or what her life has been." Both of them were remorseful as soon as they were apart, that they had succumbed to quarrelling. It demeaned them, Each preferred to think of herself as brightly generous in the face of the other's provocations. Alice was ashamed of judging her new sister-in-law. Harriet was right. There was something crabbed and narrow in how she resented the intrusion into their family. Pilar was admirable and wholesome as well as intimidating. When she'd washed up the breakfast things this morning, she had scoured the whole kitchen, left it bright and pleasant. And Harriet thought that it was true that Alice had loved the grandparents. She had been good to them when they were old, and it surely didn't matter about the letters, if there were any. What could their grandparents have written that was not blameless? Alice resumed poking into the keyhole of the little bureau with an unbent paperclip. She tried to remember Danny's swift, authoritative movement when he came to her rescue after she locked her passport in a drawer and lost the key. She imitated it now, and something gave way inside the bureau, freeing the sloping lid. With a subdued cry of triumph, not wanting to bring Harriet back, she lowered it, letting out its stale, held breath. The past was for a moment intimately at hand. Ink had dried up in a bottle of quink. Pencils and an eraser and a plastic pencil sharpener and Basild and Bond paper were stowed away in their compartments. Bills paid long ago were sorted inside the leather clips which had been someone's Christmas present. Checkbook stubs were stuffed in a pigeonhole. The lavender in one of the little voile bags her grandmother had sewed had crumbled to a powder with no smell. The arrangements preserved the traces of the hands that had last closed the lid 20 years ago. There were a few letters. No doubt there would be more in the bureau's side drawers. Alice thought she would open these too now she'd got the knack. These first letters weren't interesting. Mostly business correspondence from the last 4 or 5 years of the old lady's life when she was a widow and had managed in the house by herself. A carer had visited, and Alice had come down to be with her grandmother whenever she could, although that was also the time when she was in the thick of her disasters in the theatre. There were some photographs from the 1980s, Roland's graduation and then his PhD graduation. Fran, a skinny kid with spiky, punky hair, eyes painted black as pits. Probably Harriet had sent these. It was Harriet who had managed to keep Fran on the rails, attending school, turning up for exams, in the years after their mother died and their father left. Alice stared into the photographs of her younger self as if they were oracles. They came with a new shock because she had forgotten they were ever taken, forgotten even possessing the clothes she was wearing in them. What she remembered of that time was insecurity and self-doubt. And yet, the young woman in the photographs looked so assured and knowing, blowing out smoke, laughing with her head thrown back and eyes half closed, or haughtily made up for some party. All that time when she was drowning in the struggle and chaos of her emotions, it was as if her outward identity had led another wholly competent life in spite of her, a life which seemed admirable and even enviable. At this distance, she glanced behind her now into the room whose wallpaper was silvery in the light from the garden. No one was there. The room's stillness was all hers. Yet the chaise longue and the upright piano and the glass-fronted bookcase with her grandmother's novels in it, Elizabeth Googe and Rebecca West and L.P. Hartley, seemed drawn up stiffly against the walls in expectation. Again, Alice was subject to that intimation of something unknown in wait for her, not from the past, but from her future. Her imagination seemed strained open and consenting. Something must come into it to fulfill it. In her history, it had always been a man who filled up that quickened expectation. She was ready for another man. One bundle of letters and cards were tied together with ribbon. She realized these were condolences written when her grandfather died, along with obituaries cut from the newspapers. The cards were decorously floral. On one, a pair of black gates opened onto an autumnal avenue. Alice imagined her grandmother looking for the ribbon, fastening the letters ceremoniously together before she set them aside. "My dear Sophie, our thoughts are with you. Your sad news, if it's any comfort, privileged to have published, praying for you." The melancholy and the stuffy smell of old newspaper began to make her feel sleepy. And I'm going to read straight on from there, but I just need to tell you a tiny bit more. There are four younger ones in this, gathered together in this house for my novel. There are two. There's Molly, is the brother's daughter by his first marriage. She's 16. Alice has turned up unexpectedly, annoying the others, with a young 20-year-old man, Kazim, who is the son of her ex-boyfriend. Actually, the Danny, who's good with picking locks, is the boyfriend, and Kazim is Danny's son. And there are also two children. The youngest daughter, Fran, has two kids, Ivy and Arthur. And the only other thing you need to know is that, again on the previous day, Ivy and Arthur, exploring in the woods, have come across an old ruined cottage, which plays an important role in the book, and found dark things inside. They're not really supposed to go inside. It's precarious and locked, but they squeezed in, and they found a stash of ancient old decaying pornographic magazines in one room. And in a last room, then they pushed open the door, they found something very nasty that smelled very bad, which little Arthur identified as being the neighbor's dog in a state of advanced decomposition. And they haven't told anybody about this, and nobody's even talked about the dog being missing. Okay, so I'll pick up with the young ones, Molly, the 16-year-old. And they're stopping outside this ruined cottage in the woods. Molly stopped outside the cottage. "Oh, I remember this old place." Kazim glanced warningly at the children. They knew it meant they must not tell they'd been inside it. "Imagine living here," he said, as if he was reproaching somebody. "No electricity, no running water, no hot showers, no internet or mobile phone signal." Molly puzzled over this. "They must have had electricity. Surely everybody has electricity." Kazim waved his arms at the sky, innocent of pylons, even telegraph wires. "Do you think it just comes down out of the air?" She looked vague. "Where my family comes from," he said, "there are hundreds of thousands of people who live like this, millions actually." The others were impressed. "Where do your family come from?" "But there must be water," Arthur said. "Else, how could you drink?" Kazim made it sound as if he'd spend more time in Pakistan than he ever had. He told them about the deep wells or fetching water from streams or from standpipes miles away. He had only a quite vague idea of these things because his own relatives in Pakistan were wealthy, except that he had drunk water from a well in a country courtyard once in a house belonging to his great uncle. It seemed to him now that it must have been exceptionally pure and cold. "You might die," Arthur said. Ivy knew he was muddling up the water thing with what had happened inside the cottage. "Lots of children do," said Kazim. "They die from drinking bad water." "But not in this country," Molly added quickly, squeezing Arthur's hand. "So that's all right then," said Kazim, sardonic. He turned his back on them, but Molly picked up a lump of moss from beside the path and threw it hard at him as he walked off, hitting him accurately between the shoulder blades, spoiling his poise. For a long instant, he was astonished and offended, and then, to their relief, he yelled as if letting go some pent-up outrage, scooped up the moss again, and threw it back just as hard at Molly. And this was the signal for the resumption of the pelting game they had played earlier. Molly and Arthur went hurrying in search of things to throw. In the slanting, syrupy afternoon light, because they were dreamy with tiredness and heat, they seemed to be bending and shrieking and thudding along the path in pleasurable slow motion. Ivy hung back in the clearing. Soon the shouts of the others sounded remote among the trees below, and she had the sensation again that she'd had earlier at the pool of seeing herself from treetop height, remote and doll-like. Crossing the clearing and tugging at the cottage door, she imagined she was someone else, another, more braver, more audacious girl in a children's story. Ivy wasn't brave. She was a coward when it came to sports or party games, the kind where you ran in a team and had to burst a balloon by sitting on it. But she also had a greedy curiosity, which was like a hunger. She wanted to get clear all by herself and without the shame of other people knowing she was doing it, the truth of what could happen. Still squeezing inside the cottage door, she longed to find it scoured and empty, a clean breeze blowing through its harmless shell. The brown, dull light in the downstairs room and the frozen urgency of the tipped chair were just the same as yesterday. Her footsteps broke into the silence she and Arthur had left behind them. Halfway up the stairs, she spun round and almost fell with fright when the door swung shut behind her. But this simplified things, because going back now was as dreadful as going on. The magazines and the dead dog had become one composite idea in her mind. The magazines a necessary preliminary to the rest. And she turned the damp, clumped, unglossy pages boldly because Arthur wasn't watching, taking possession this time of what she saw, the bleached paper flesh in all its configurations, on and on, endlessly different and the same. Who were these women? Because she knew the pictures were for grown-ups, she couldn't get over their gratuitous childishness and rudeness. Yet she couldn't discount them completely. They stirred some tingling possibility in her as well as fierce distaste. Then she opened the door which she and Arthur had pulled shut behind them and crossed the threshold into the second room, pinching her nose tight shut with her fingers, breathing through her mouth. Still, the smell of rot was in her throat, intimate and filthy. The room wasn't as dark as before. Light came and went because a breeze was blowing in the scraps of curtain. She had not noticed yesterday that the window was not quite closed. The fat sluggishness of the flies and their inconsequential spurts of buzzing disgusted her. She thought she couldn't bear it if one buzzed against her. Yet once she was actually inside the room, she forgot to be frightened. Everything was quiet apart from the flies, even peaceful. There was no one here except herself. She could do what she liked. She could see uninhibitedly. Mitzi, the dog, was both something and nothing at the same time. A mass in one corner was darkened and flattened with a stain spread round it on the floorboards as if fluids had seeped out of it then dried. Only the patches of russet red curls clinging onto the mass in places made it Mitzi. An eye socket was a pit in the skull showing white through its leathery covering. When Ivy crouched to examine the remains more closely, not too close, she saw, at first incredulous and then with dawning certainty, that white living maggots, fine as threads, were wriggling in the dog's body in the places where the flesh was still clinging to the bones. Reaching this farthest shore of her discovery, Ivy let out a noise that was only for herself, wounded like a low groan of protest. She was fascinated, though. She didn't move from watching them until she heard the others shouting her name from the woods. And then I thought, to finish with, I'd read just a little bit from that section. It's not quite in the middle, when I dropped back all those years to 1968. So it's the same house, the adults that you've met, Alice and Harriet and their brother Roland are children. Their grandfather is the vicar in the church. Their grandmother, Sophie, is outwardly at least the conventional vicar's wife. The younger sister, Fran, is not actually born yet. And we're at a moment when Jill, their mother, still very much alive, has gathered up her children and left her husband and brought her children home to the country, though she hadn't actually told her parents anything about what she's doing there. They may be making their half guesses, but she's just said, oh, on an impulse, I'm here. And this is the children sort of acclimatizing back to life in the country, which they know well anyway. And then it's a significant conversation between Jill, who is Alice and Harriet and Roland's mother, and Jill's mother, Sophie, their grandmother. In those late afternoons, their mother sometimes played the piano, and the sound came floating out past Alice, eating through the daisies in her playpen set on the lawn, to where Hetty and Roland were busy in the stream, building a dam across it, Hetty snapping out orders to Roland. Hetty is Harriet, of course. The music, while it lasted, seemed to frame and characterize their life in a way which was poignant and satisfying, as if they could see it from a long way off. The children were always surprised that their mother could play at all. The piano seemed to speak quintessentially of acres of empty time dedicated to dreamy introspection, which they did not associate with her. Then Jill would break off impatiently when she made a mistake in the middle of some rippling passage, crashing both her hands down on the piano keys, crossly slamming the lid shut. They were half aware that their mother was boiling up with trouble the whole time they were adapting to life in Kinkham, settling down there. "I can't bear this," she said aloud once, rather calmly, with her hands still raised in that impressive way, curving and passionate, poised above the notes. "What can't you bear?" Sophie said. She was patting out a soft dough for scones with floury hands on the kitchen table. Jill had come in to cook the baby's supper and was crouching, banging through the saucepans in a corner cupboard looking for a small one. "Not being able to play through those pieces I used to know. It's so frustrating." Her mother began pressing a glass into the dough, cutting rounds of scone and setting them out on a baking tray, while Jill sat back thoughtfully on her heels on the linoleum with the saucepan in her hand. "And that's not all. There's quite a lot I can't bear just at the moment. My husband, for instance, if you really want to know. That marriage is pretty much over, I should say. I made a mistake with Tom and it hasn't worked out, so there we are." She put on a sprightly, debunking voice as if all this was a subject for a light, bright, clever irony. And Sophie went on pressing the glass into the dough, close up each time against the last cut-out round for minimum waste. "I knew something was wrong," she exclaimed, but without looking at her daughter. "I decided to come back and live down here," Jill said. "Mikey Waller's helping me look for a place to rent. Perhaps I could find a little job. I thought you wouldn't mind looking after the children just a couple of mornings a week." "What kind of little job?" "Anything. I don't care. I thought of asking in the library." "You're a wicked girl," Sophie said. When she had stamped out as many rounds as she could, she gathered up the leftovers, pressing them together into a new ball, flattening this with deft fingers. "To tempt me so dreadfully. I can't think of anything I'd rather have in the whole world than all of you living down here. I'd be so happy having you nearby all the time. Or here at the rectory, for goodness sake, what are all those spare rooms for? Helping you look after the children. I'd like it more than anything." "But," Jill said, "you're going to say, but it's not possible, but I have to be good or something. We can't all just have what we want in life. You're going to remind me of my duty that I ought to stay with him for the sake of the children or whatever. Those things don't mean anything anymore, Mum. They don't count for anything. Women have seen through them. Anyway, you haven't even asked what's wrong. So, what's wrong? Jill sighed and put up the cool metal of the saucepan against her face. He sleeps with other women for a start. That's the easy bit. Sophie began stamping out new scone rounds, dipping the glass into the flour bag, grinding it down thoughtfully into the dough. How many other women? Mum, you're funny. What does it matter how many? I don't know. One at least, quite definite, that he's owned up to recently. I found her underwear, if you want to know the sordid detail, in my bed when I stripped it to wash the sheets, all crumpled up, sort of fossilised, because I don't wash them that often. Down over the edge at the end, caught between the layers. He brought her home when I took the children off to Candice Markham's for the weekend. They must have hunted everywhere. She had to go home without her knickers, poor Vander. She must have thought he'd stolen them to keep them in his pocket or something. Frilly red nylon ones that couldn't possibly ever have been mine. In the underwear department, I'm still very much the vicar's daughter in my white cotton. Poor Vander. He doesn't even like her very much. Jill said she was sure there'd been other women too. Two at least that I have my suspicions over. He's probably with someone right now, some dirty little Parisian Maoist he's got off with on the manifestation. The point is, he doesn't seem to have qualms as long as he can get away with it, but the unfaithfulness isn't the major problem. Maybe he's right. We don't need to own each other. Maybe I could get lovers of my own. We could balance things out. It was lucky, Jill thought, that she was sitting here on the floor. From her unusual perspective, everything in this kitchen that was familiar as life itself looked unexpected. So that these extraordinary words, which didn't belong in here, could flow freely out of her mouth, liberated by the room's new strangeness. She could see from where she was sitting the grubby, stained underside of the kitchen table, the side which was not bleached each week by Mrs. Cummins. A metal strut that had been screwed in at some point, fastening the top more securely against the legs. The real problem is that I don't admire Tom anymore. I mean, intellectually, as a thinker and a writer, I used to believe he was so brilliant. I chose him as my guide to everything. He showed me how to find my way in the world. But now I can see all the lazy patterns in his thinking, all the shortcuts. He doesn't really know half as much as he pretends he does. He's full of enthusiasms. He doesn't think things through deeply. I can see through falsity more quickly. I'm better at connecting things up together. I don't know how to be with him if I can't look up to him. I'm programmed to believe that the man I choose must be my master. I know that's an absurd expectation, but I can't seem to unpick it from where it's stitched into my psyche. Jill had never said any of these things aloud before. She hardly even knew if they were true. And her mother didn't care anyway about cleverness. She wouldn't be on Jill's side over that. She believed that women should keep their skepticism and criticism hidden, not risk exposing themselves as the men exposed themselves by pronouncing with any certainty. She would disapprove of the language of intellectual competition which Jill had used. She would have her secret irony at that. But at the same time, she must be at least half triumphant, hearing all these things about Tom. In recent years, Jill's relationship with her mother had often seemed to be a silent tussle. Sophie's unspoken judgment against Tom pushing up against her daughter's defense of him. Now Sophie was painting the tops of the scones with egg and milk beaten together, and she asked Jill what she was going to cook for the baby's dinner. Would Alice eat the cauliflower cheese left over from yesterday? Jill stared hopelessly into the empty pan. She didn't like it very much, did she? I was imagining some boiled potatoes with peas and grated cheese on top. That sounds like a good solution. Sophie opened the oven door in the Rayburn with a tea towel, slid the tray of scones inside, rummaged in the vegetable crock for potatoes. You'd be surprised, she said, how you can think you've made up your mind about things and got to the bottom of them, and then there's a sort of swerve in the road or you turn a corner and everything looks different all over again. as if you're driving through a new landscape. Really? Does that really happen? Sophie considered carefully. To a certain extent. Jill slumped in her corner as if a certain extent wasn't enough. Incidentally, her mother said, I don't care as much as you might imagine about being good, but I really don't think you ought to come home, however much I would love it. I think you ought to stay out there in the world where things are happening. If I were you, then that's what I would want. I wouldn't want to come back here. There's nothing for you here. I'll stop there.
That was fantastic. That was great. I was struck, I didn't write any of this down, but I was struck by how well you read dialogue, and really fantastically, don't you think? I mean, so these characters, Harriet, Fran, Alice, Roland, now Jill, what's unusual to me is not only how well you read it aloud, but really that you're not an intrusive author, that you're letting them talk. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, yes, that's, I'm sure you recognize that, Meg, that sometimes when you're writing, I mean, it isn't something mystic, is it? It's not like, oh, you have to sort of go into a trance and the person appears to you and dictates what's going to be on the page. But I always know when I'm fiddling, when I'm weighing in the scales against a character, or for them, or writing a sort of, you know, twisting things to say something about them.
That's right, and it feels unfair to them.
It feels unfair. It feels false on the page.
Yeah.
Often I think it's an aesthetic reaction even more than a moral one, actually. It just writes badly.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that for me, that's what editing is for. You can see it. Do you read aloud when you... Do you ever do that?
I don't read aloud. No, I don't. But I read very... I think learning to be the reader of your own work is absolutely it.
Oh, yeah.
So I am endlessly rereading with my eyes.
It's almost like reading aloud. It's like
it's
I realize
like
that's
aloud.
Kind of a dumb question.
Yeah.
As I said it, I want to kind of take it back. Because you are reading it aloud
you
in your head, right?
Yeah.
In
you're reading slowly and you're hearing the rhythm of the sentence.
So you know if you've given one of the characters a false line.
Yeah.
You know that and you'll take it back, right? And it's only confirmed the good things when you read aloud, how that you were right to make that decision.
Yeah.
But I really thought that so many writers, I find, you feel the presence of God, the writer as God, and you feel them moving around the characters on a sort of board, and you don't want to do that, right?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, in some ways, of course, you are God. It's such a funny thing to invent this world, invent these people, decide what will happen to them, be in as many of their heads as you like, but it's a double act. You are in one sense controlling it, and in another sense, you must let it have its own life.
Well, you said you were talking to some high school students earlier, and you said something about the combination of like dreaminess and control that you and that's right, that state that you need to go into write fiction, right? Can you speak to that a little bit?
Yes, it's another really fundamental contradiction or tension, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because obviously to do such a strange thing as make up people who don't actually exist and tell a story about them, it clearly connects up to that bit of one's mind which dreams and fantasizes. I think interestingly, the more I've written, the less I've fantasized. That's you know, there is a very direct link between those two activities, but the difference in writing from fantasy is that there is another self who is, if you like, severe, who is the controller, the one who must make it tell the truth, who will not allow your fantasy to be full of wish fulfillment and happy ending and flattery, mm-hmm. who is exacting about truthfulness. So, yes. So those two things.
It's a weird combination of you have to believe in yourself, but you have to have a modesty too, because you have to step back and let them do the work. But they're not really doing it. They're not that whole thing where people say the town is the character or the. My mother heard something once. I don't know who said it, but people say something like, "Oh, the book wrote itself." Somebody said, "I don't know who it is." The book that writes itself will have to read itself, and I think that may be true.
Nice, isn't it? Right?
It really may be true because that control. You need to have, and you so clearly do have it, but it's a modest control.
That's really nice.
Yeah, I feel that so much in your work. I was thinking, so the first line of this book, I always, during an introduction, I like never to read from the book because invariably the writer was going to read that line, and now you've ruined it for them. And I've stepped on so many feet that way, and I never want to do it again, so I didn't. But the book opens this way. Alice was the first to arrive, but she discovered as she stood at the front door that she had forgotten her key. It strikes me that all books, like the way into a novel, it's like an advent calendar. There are a lot of different doors or windows you could go in. What is the meaning of entering the book this way, through an actual entry? What were you thinking?
Through an actual entry to which you don't have the key.
Which you don't have the key, right, exactly.
And certainly Alice doesn't have the key. And in fact, what they do, she arrives with Kazim, and none of the others are there, so she can't get in. And they walk around the house, and they peer into it through the windows, and it seems like a dream house. It seems unattainable because they can't get inside it. So that's sort of the place I wanted to go in. I wanted us to feel the house and for a little while not be able to enter it and feel it's more than its selfness, you know.
Did you know that you wanted that feeling at the opening?
And I started with that right from the beginning. I never had any alternative opening or anything. And I think I had that sentence. I think that was the first sentence I wrote.
It does seem sort of perfect in terms of what you wanted to do. It really does. It gives you that. I mean, what do you think about memory and the past? I mean, this notion that we've had these full lives filled with people. And when we summon them up as fiction writers, like, would you know Alice on the street?
I'd have to be inside her, and then I would. I don't. Yes. She isn't anybody. She isn't anybody actual. She isn't.
Right.
She isn't a real person. She's a composite, of course, from all sorts of stolen bits and pieces. And I was just talking about it the other day, and I realised for the first time that, of course, she's a little bit like my mother, which hadn't occurred to me because she's not my mother's age, but my mother is brilliant with makeup and clothes, and she has a gift of making somewhere a lovely little place, very different in other ways. So I steal things from here and there.
You borrow. It's that scavenging thing that writers do,
absolutely.
Right? It's that thing. We can't help but do it. I mean, you're all in my next book. We can't help but do it because what else? Where do people do ask writers that question, and writers are very, where do your ideas come from? And writers say that snide thing, Cleveland or whatever. But the truth is, they do, it's actually a legitimate question.
Do you feel that as well? Do you think that could you recognize your characters on the street?
No, they're kind of like on a reality show, the ones who didn't want to be photographed, they have a blurry face, you know.
Yeah, sort of, I think mine have slightly blurry faces.
Yeah, I don't care about their faces, right?
I know, I think one knows something about the tone of their presence.
Yes.
You know whether they stir people when they come into a room or whether they're unnoticeable, whether they slide in the back of a room. You know things like that about them and how they hold themselves when they move. And maybe the sound of their laugh or something like that.
I think this is something that all writers do know. Right. And when you're showing these people, you're not just listening in on them at any moment. It's a concentrate of a moment, right?
Yeah.
There's a reason you chose this day, this conversation between them.
Yes, everything without being labored, everything is illustrative. And by the end of the book, you, the writer and the reader, should feel you don't actually need to know anything more about those people, even though huge acres of their lives are, they're not there. You have actually taken a tiny selection But you should feel that selection gives you everything you need to know.
It's really, thinking about it now and hearing your description of it, I can't really think of another form for which that's true. The novel seems singularly, it's so well described this way. But then it leads me to ask you, what does that do? I mean, my first writing teacher was the novelist Mary Gordon, and she said to us some of the best advice that I'd ever gotten, really, which is, only write about what's important. And what she meant is that there's sort of parenthetical there, write about what's important to you.
Yeah.
So what's important in telling this moment about these people? You can answer that generally, specifically, however you want.
Yes, no, I think it's such a good thing to say as a teacher, and and it's sort of, also don't write the boring bits. That's so easy that when you're first writing a novel, you think, I've got these really exciting hotspots that I'm longing to tell, and they're important. And then I've got to
get them out
of the door and into the car, and they clean their teeth, and then I get to another good bit. And of course, when you discover, I just leave a little bit of space on the page.
White space.
Line
breaks are a writer's greatest tool, aren't they? They're incredible.
And I actually don't know when they first get used.
Right.
They're not there in somebody like Dickens, are they?
No.
Chapter breaks, obviously, but not inside.
But what I think is interesting about that, too, is that when you don't put them in, when you feel that you have to show people getting out her key, it's, you know, shall we get the check, Jane said to John, as if we would think they stayed in the restaurant for the rest of their lives if we didn't show them going to bed.
Yeah.
Right? You can just have them in bed.
Yes. But you know, it is one of the hardest things, because you have, if you simply say, "Whoa, this spaghetti is delicious," he moved his head on the pillow, that will sound crazy. So
you have to think of
two sentences, either a white space,
I know,
which is easy,
yeah,
but occasionally you can't over.
You have another trick? I'm listening very well here.
You just have to wait for ages while you find two sentences that move them from the restaurant to the bed.
Although not to criticize that, but I will say, sometimes aren't those the sort of unnecessary stitch? Because isn't it like in an interview with a celebrity, where the sort of interviewer kind of makes things up for flow, says something like, you know, Tom Cruise took a sip of his cappuccino. It's like, we didn't need that to get to the next thing that Tom Cruise says.
Yeah, no, that's definitely not a good join between
but
each spaghetti.
But like, what else could you do other than a line space? Like just a reflection, like a moment of...
I find it so hard that I can't think of an example to illustrate it, but I sort of, you do sometimes, I was writing this something only just before I came to America, and I had a great long stretch of it that worked, and I had a finale to the scene, and I had four people sitting together, and I didn't want to give the feeling that only a couple of minutes were passing. I needed time to pass. Now, that's so hard, isn't it? That when you just want two sentences, you don't want to bore anyone, you've kind of got everything set.
So you put in a giant hourglass.
You somewhere put in an hourglass, and you have to make it feel completely natural. And it took me 2 hours to get that. And it's they're completely inconspicuous little join.
How did you do it?
I actually don't think I know. You just wait till you find... What did I do? I described one of the people sitting there, and I summarized a little bit of conversation between him and somebody else. That's what I did. So I felt time passing. This is terribly technical, isn't it?
Yeah.
But no, it's really fascinating when you're doing it.
But I think, actually, it's really fascinating to me. I think that what's fascinating here is that that you know that you need to do it. Once you know the need, then you'll find the thing. Mm. But it's knowing that you need to do it. Otherwise, there's that feeling of some novels, some short stories, there's like no sense of room temperature. But with your work, I feel quite often, I know, and it's a very abstract question, really. I know when I'm reading your work, and I tried to get that a little bit in what I said before, but what is it that you know about a writer? Like, how do you know when you're reading Joyce? How do you know when you're reading a story in Dubliners? Mm. What is it?
Yeah, it's as if a writer whose work is working gets their temperament, the texture of their thought onto the page. If I'm thinking about Dubliners or Alice Munro, they somehow deliver the the feeling of the spaces inside their mind and its sensuality onto the page, don't they? As something that one feels tangibly, way below the level of thought. You're right, it's textural.
And we know also, going back to what Mary Gordon said, we know what's important to them.
Yeah.
So we sort of almost inhabit that, and we're waiting for it to show up. So you write stories quite frequently and novels, and I was thinking about a line that Margaret Atwood said, only half jokingly, that novels are about time and poetry is about eternity. So I would say, what is the short story about?
That's a really difficult one to answer.
To answer it, no.
Much more corny thing that I've sometimes found myself saying is that a novel is like a marriage.
Oh.
And a poem is presumably a one-night stand, and a short story is a sort of brief and wonderful love affair. There we are, that's my...
So, okay.
Slightly...
Well, that will lead me into asking you about writing about sex, because you do it well, and you... Are there some rules for people who are writing? What do you think? I mean, what... When you're writing about sex, is it like writing about anything else? Do you feel?
No, it isn't, is it? It's a funny thing, because actually, if a certain kind of writing about sex can over affect the reader, it does touch something biological in us. Yes. You want people to feel that what's going on is sexy, but you don't want them to forget they're reading your novel about your people. Yes. So there's a really complicated bit of tact about that. And I would say that probably what happens with me is that I tend to write more in a first draft, and then sometimes with the help of my wonderful editors, just cut a little bit. And less is more in that. Less is more. It remains inside the novel instead of dangerously, as both perhaps sex and violence can do this, take you off out of the story and out of the created world into a reactive place where you're almost biologically sort of stimulated or responding or appalled.
Although some fiction that has shocking things in it, deaths, say, not even violent death, but a sudden, even an off-page death, we respond to in that way too, right? Is that not...
But that's so interesting that you say off page, because I think if you act... I mean, I... No, there are great pieces of writing that hideously, viscerally describe a death. Actually, I'm just rereading Buddenbrooks, and that goes some. Superbly done, and he doesn't flinch from it. But on the whole...
Because you have Mrs. Ramsey...
And that's totally off the page.
It's off the page. Mm. It had already happened when that section begins.
Yeah.
And yet, when I think about that book, it's so powerful, and it sort of almost sickens me a little bit to think about that.
The role? It's easier to write reactions than write head-on with violence, and I think actually with sex as well. It's easier to convey what's there inside the secret space by panning around everybody outside it or picking up the periphery, you actually create the power of the thing in the middle. And there's a great risk in just simply, let's just name this, let's name body parts, let's describe injuries or whatever. Yeah. There's a danger that you sort of burn it out and it loses its power. And I think you keep the power more strongly by turning your camera or whatever it is to look around at the effect. I've just been, for some reason, it's on the front of Buddenbrooks, that's why. But also, when I was in MoMA the other day, looking at a bit of Munch painting, and he paints wonderful, wonderful, terrible pictures of sickness and sick rooms. But what you're looking at is rarely so much the person in the bed. It's the crowd assembled round the bed and the medicine bottles on the table and the kind of prostrate attitudes of people in the room, which convey to you the power of what's happening.
Yeah. As you're talking, you're using your hands in this way. And I love it. It's almost like it wants to become physical. It wants to be describing a physical activity, a craft, in a way, really. And bringing up visual art, do you feel like Is there connective tissue between your work and painting? I mean, do you feel?
I love painting. I love it, but I've never, ever, ever painted anything since I was at school. I think
there
about
is, right? It's painterly.
When I, and I do sometimes think, actually, this was interesting. This cropped up in the class I was teaching here last night. Often what you need when you look at a piece of your work and you think, I haven't, let's say, made the grief of that loss come out strongly enough here. And you're not thinking, I need to explain how badly they grieved. You're thinking, I need to put some black brush strokes in. That's you need to put the sentences in that have the texture, to pick up your word, or the tonality to create the emotion. It is more like brush strokes than it is like a chemical formula, an analysis, isn't it?
It strikes me very much so with your work in particular, and I was thinking of it particularly in the short stories, actually. I feel it. That is really true, so I sort of thought that was the case. Are you interested also in psychoanalysis in some way? I feel like you're... I
never have been analysed, and I don't know... I know a little about it, of course. Of course I'm interested in it, yes. But I'm not expert, so it doesn't... No, I'm not expert.
You seem sort of like a kind of good analyst. So you don't have to have been analyzed. You can go right to having a clinical practice.
Well, I did think my house, of course, is very Jungian, isn't it? Isn't that a Jung symbolism?
Yes.
The house with the... I've always loved that. I think I don't probably go along with lots of what Jung believed about the psyche, but I think to imagine both us individually and our culture as a great building with a basement full of bones and an attic full of light and everything in between and shut rooms. I mean, houses are metaphors. They don't need any work.
Yes. Well, symbolism, I want to get to questions from the audience, but I just want to ask you one more thing about symbolism, actually. So there was that great Flannery O'Connor line that I'll probably butcher a little bit, but it was in Mystery and Manners, and it was part of a talk that she gave, and she was talking about the short story Good Country People. Mm-hmm. And there's a daughter who's furious with her mother and snobby and hates everyone and hates the town, the people her mother associates with, and she has a wooden leg. And the wooden leg is stolen from her by a Bible salesman. And I've given it away, I'm sorry, but still read it. If you haven't, which you probably have. And they asked her, you know, was the wooden leg a symbol? And Flannery O'Connor said, yes, I think she said yes, but before it's a symbol, it has to be a wooden leg.
Yeah, that's it. That's it, exactly. And the point of why symbols and metaphors work on our imagination is that all the time in our perception, we see objects and they are filled up with meaning for us, obviously, and they are potent with history and intention and upset. That's why that apparatus works. It's not a literary device.
No.
It's a deep psychological
Yeah, it's
mechanism.
Almost like writers are sort of doing these objects and people a favor by giving them, you know, the meaning that they have already.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah. And you certainly are doing that in this beautiful book. So I'm sure there are questions from the audience. So how are we doing that?
I don't know.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
That's better.
Because we didn't even know. Oh, yeah, there you are. If anyone wants to, I guess, stand, or...
Oh, a hand? There's a hand.
Yeah.
I'm curious, are there moments when you are writing where you feel more at ease and choose a book that you... Or I would say when you are writing, are there moments when you choose not to read a certain book?
Okay, he's asked, in case you didn't hear, I think I'm understanding, are there moments when I'm writing when I choose not to read a certain book? Do you mean because it might influence me or get in the way of what I'm doing myself? Yeah, and a lot of writers do say that. We must ask Meg as well what she does. I don't think so. I think I might, if I'm going to begin writing, I might avoid reading something silly. And I sometimes, when I'm about to start, one of the things I might do is read one of the books closest to me, the things I truly love, almost like a bridge into writing. But Do you know, I could never stop reading. I'm just, reading's first, really. Writing is everything, but reading is first. So I've never not read when I'm writing. Meg, what about
you? I would
just
say to that, when I'm writing, I like to read things that I feel the author was excited about when he or she was writing.
Yeah.
I like to sort of feel that I can connect somehow to a moment that the author did the little Snoopy dance, was excited about something they wrote. Because one thing that can happen if you're writing, there's a moment in the middle of a book when you might lose energy and feel this.
Absolutely. And reading somebody else is like a shot in the arm.
It makes you remember
the
feeling you had at the beginning. It's like the why you fell in love with that person.
Thank you. And I'll tell you who does that for me most usefully, I think, is the English writer, or Anglo-Irish writer, Elizabeth Bowen. And there's something about the packedness and density of her sentences, which, if ever mine are getting slack, I sort of read a bit of her and I think, oh, don't waste space, you know.
And you modeled, and the structure of this book is
Bowen-esque. She has, in her marvellous novel, House in Paris, she has a first section called The Present, a middle section called The Past, and a third section called The Present. And I was just reading that. I thought, oh, that's what I want. And thought I would just steal it.
It's a durable thing, yeah.
Any more questions?
Yes.
One at the back. Okay. Howard's End, which is an Ian Forster novel. I'll tell you what I've seen recently, the film of it, which was good. And I do know it, and is it an influence? I'm not sure. I like Forster very much, but probably not quite as much as Ford and Lawrence and some of his contemporaries. He's a beautiful, I know what you're thinking of. There's the social comedy I like, and I would love to feel I was doing that using class and playing games with class and having lots of fun. I feel he's a despairing writer about class, though, and that's where I probably hold back from him. I think he has very little hope. Howard's End upsets me because I want it to be all right. I want them to get on, why ever not? And it's sort of all doomed because he's too low a class and she's making a mistake. And that's sad. He's a very pessimistic writer, I think. He's got a lovely light surface and a very good comic touch, which disguises something very, very sad inside. Yeah, interesting.
Someone else?
Any more questions?
Yes, from there.
In the sense that when I'm writing a novel, I will break off and write stories, which is a lovely, refreshing thing to do, in fact, because inevitably when you're writing a novel, there are barren stretches when you lose faith, you don't believe in it, it's not working, you're stuck. And nothing could be nicer than the irresponsibility of that love affair that I was suggesting, you know, leave your marriage for a bit and write a story. Stories are so irresponsible, you can just throw things into them and you will never need to follow them through. They have to be good and it has to be there, as Meg was saying, everything has to be there, meaning something, counting for something. But if you say, you know, this was the point when my crazy aunt with the wooden leg had, you know, made love to the Bible salesman, you never need to mention that again. Whereas in a novel, you will actually need to sort of follow through on the aunt and what became of the Bible salesman and did she get another wooden leg? It's a lovely, refreshing thing to write a short story.
Do novels need, do they have to be shapely?
Yeah, I think so, don't you?
Yes, that was a trick question.
Yes.
Now I can still like you, right? Yes.
They have.
No, but I ask that because there are some novels that sort of throw in the kitchen sink and, you know.
Loose, baggy monsters, Henry James called them.
Yes.
Although, mind you, he was talking about War and Peace, which I certainly would not think of as a messy novel. But maybe
it is. It is shapely, though, in a way.
It is. It is. It's just that everything's so brilliant that it has to be there. So,
but it's also shaped around different. The different sections are shaped around different ideas.
They are. They are. James is wrong about Tolstoy. This is a really useful thing with students. When they come to me, as they will do, this is just starting up now back in the UK when I get back meeting my new people I will be tutoring. They come with a fantastic story idea for a novel, and they sort of know what's going to happen at the end, and they've written a beautiful, you hope, some of them have written a beautiful opening, and they have absolutely no idea what to do with this great long stretch in the middle. And when you say to them, what's going to happen a third of the way in? What's going to happen two-thirds of the way in? And kind of make them draw, not a horrible plan with post-its or anything grim like that, but a great big circle and feel the shape, feel where it's going to pause and rest and have, you know, something momentous that they can write towards, and then another big sweep. So it has to be shaped.
Well, I guess I think maybe in a way, shape is meaning.
Yeah. Yeah.
So maybe that's the thing. It's like you don't have to worry exactly about where they walk across the middle of the book. Mm. But if you have what I like to consider the imperative, if you know that, if you're armed with that at the beginning of the book, and you therefore can imbue the things with meaning that are waiting to take the meaning, you can get there.
Yeah, that's right. Shape is meaning. That's right. And the amount of proportion you give to an element of the book is part of its meaning, isn't it? And if you big up something, make it huge, then that's going to take that much weight in the whole point of the book,
right.
what the reader comes away with. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Any more questions?
I just want to ask, when you said there's important moments and you should write the important things, there's acres of boring things, do you sometimes write some of the acres of boring things to help yourself find the interesting things? And I also wanted to ask about when you recognize bits of characters in a character you're writing, is it almost disappointing to you? You want that real person to go away?
The second thing first, I don't think so. No, I think I'm fine with that. I suppose the only anxiety is that the person will recognize. Remember, my stepson once slipped in his mum's shower and grabbed the curtain and pulled the whole curtain rail and everything down. And I used that and had to sort of apologize to him because it was a slightly loser character. And I didn't really mean to imply that he was a loser. So little things like that are a bit awkward. But I don't mind that as long as I can get away with it. And another secret is that sometimes I steal things from books. Not I would never steal, you know, like an explicit, brilliant thing that some writer had done. But I think he's like that. He's like that character. She reminds me, she's a bit, I sometimes have like a Dostoevsky character, you know. And that I think that. It's a vague thought rather than a very explicit one, but it really helps. The first question about the boring bits. I think writers are really different, and I do think quite a lot of writers do write very long drafts and then go back in and do a lot of cutting. And I don't. I write small and short and slow, really slow. And if I'm feeling it's boring, I can't go forward. It's horrible. It's a horrible feeling. And I go back and I find the next interesting thing to say, or I spend 2 hours trying to find the two sentences that join my piece together. So I'm slow and painful, actually.
Have you ever written a book where you felt you were almost the amanuensis for the thing? You were just sort of typing it out. You already had it fully formed in some way?
No, but paragraphs can feel like that.
Yeah.
That's it. That's the thing you're wanting, isn't it? That's the sweet spot when, for a moment, you just can't stop typing and it's just pouring out. But I can't. And that's never happened for a whole book. Not even for a whole story, I don't think. There's some, maybe a short story will almost pour out just beautifully.
Have you had examples of, you put something in, you didn't know why it was there, and then later you use it in some way, new way, and then you get a chill of pleasure, and you know?
I'm not sure I can think, I know that's happened, absolutely.
And then that's why I was thinking about psychoanalysis, or the unconscious, really.
Yeah.
Because why did you put that thing in there? Yes. I've seen this so many times with writers. Maybe you know what I'm talking about. You read something and there's like a mention of an object And then later on, the object is imbued with something else. And the if you ask the writer, they'll often say, no, I didn't know. Yeah. I just chose that blue cup. And then later on, it takes on some greater meaning. And did the writer know it without knowing it?
It's mysterious. We must be feeling for things where we don't know why. I mean, the great example of that is Jane Eyre, isn't it? Where Charlotte Bronte wrote a very conservative novel that was very hostile to her madwoman in the attic, who was swarthy and animal-like and repulsive. But she left about 100 clues in the text, which enabled Jean Rhys to come along and write her magnificent Wide Sagacity, which completely takes the side of the woman in the attic. And you know that Charlotte Bronte did not consciously give her, for instance, her name is Bertha, which is a rather earthy, heavy name, but she gave her Antoinette for a middle name. Isn't that extraordinary? How did she know that she had to? She didn't know.
And it also had to wait for time to pass.
It had to wait for time to pass. That's
modern era, contemporary era. Yeah.
That's the one that really astonishes me. I've forgotten now. I once had an English literature student who did a study of this, and it was as if there were 20 clues that Charlotte Bronte had unconsciously, I'm sure of it, planted for a future revisionist reading of. That's extraordinary, isn't it?
Who knows what's in your books?
Yeah.
Anything else?
Was there somebody who had a question there? Yeah.
Go on. I just wanted to say I rediscovered you again after many years in Silk Brocade, which is in New York.
Oh, it's a great story.
Yes, that's a good point. I mean, when I said you should feel you've had everything, that isn't like a closed quantity, but it should feel like a box that you've put the lid on, but the box is still there and full of stuff, as it were, that one could revisit, which is lovely. Yeah, I am, and I'm about, I don't know what, quarter of the way through, a little bit more even than that, and very different and structurally more complicated. So that's my. I don't think I'm worried. I think it's okay. It's different. I don't want to say too much, but I am, and I always have done that since I was published. I've always been working on a new thing by the time something came out, because otherwise, well, apart from anything else, now. What do I do with my days? It's what I do. I love to do it. I get very scratchy if I haven't been writing for a couple of weeks. Over Christmas, I'm just cooking, being with my family, and it's all lovely. And then, something's wrong. Why am I in this bad temper? And I realize what it is. But also, it's kind of wise, rather than just waiting to see whether people are going to like it or not, to be busy with a new project. Do you do this as well, Meg? Do you start something new before?
I try. Yeah, if writers are happy when they're writing. Well, not happy. Yeah. That may be.
No, not happy.
That's the wrong word. But we can't bear it when we're not.
No, we can't bear it when we're not. That's it. That's beautifully put.
Yes. Is that it? Well, thank. Oh, there's another one. Okay.
Sorry, who is he compared to?
As just like two great, as one great writer and one great painter of their time. So I was just wondering if you would consider any one painter you'd be particularly keen on if you like it, or something of that sort.
Well, surprisingly,
He's asking me which painter would I choose if I could sort of choose one as an analogy to what I'm trying to do. Can I answer that? I don't know. Who are the? I sort of can a little, very, very, very hesitantly, because this is a great painter. But I love the French 18th century painter Chardin, who paints the exquisite still lives of heaps of fruit and junks and coffee. And I actually have a little print of a Chardin still life up above my desk. And I think that's about witness. It's about just the thingness of things in the world. And that's what one wants to do, the extraordinary power of presence of stuff. So actually, I have got an answer to that, and that's him.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for this. It was wonderful.
Thank you, Meg. Beautifully done.